But do you have a problem, Jeffrey? If you were a guide, would you have a problem?
Yes.
Would you have a problem if you guided somebody, let's say like Jacob Pertinsky on the Manistee River, if you're Jacob Pertinsky and you guide someone on a salmon trip and then you feel super official because you're Jacob Pertinsky right now. He's like stretching. He's like married to Cheyenne. But they got married, by the way. Congratulations to Jacob and Cheyenne. Now both Bartinskys. Paul would be so proud to know that this was made it. But if you're, let's say you're Jacob Bartinsky, you do guided hunts or guided fishing trips on the Manistee River for salmon. You take somebody out, you teach them, they catch fish, good success, they pay, you're happy, tip, whatever, everything's good. 2 weeks later, you see them in their own boat in the exact same spot where you showed them how to salmon fish, catching salmon, doing exactly what you taught them.
Can you open carry up in Manistee?
Whoa.
Get out of my spot. That's my spot.
What do you think? So, AJ, because you look confused for a second.
Well, there. I didn't know. Are you saying, like, is that okay?
Is it ethical? Like, a guide takes you, shows you a spot on public waters, mm-hmm. and then you go out and just do exactly what he taught you.
I don't agree with that. There's nothing, like, legally wrong
with
that.
Yeah, why are you against it? Is it like a moral thing?
To me, if someone taught me something, then I was going to their spot and taking it. It's like with the woodcock spot. If someone brought you hunting, like, I mean, you're an idiot if you bring someone to your woodcock spot, but or you're like your morel mushrooms, but if you go back to their spot and just take everything they have and what they taught you, sure. I think that's unfair.
In that
it's in bad taste.
Specific yeah. case, I think I would, number one, be okay with it because they'd have to go out and buy a boat. They'd have to go out and buy all the different reels and rods and stuff in order to make all that happen. So they had to invest a lot. You got someone who's buying stuff, paying taxes that goes back towards conservation. You got someone now buying licenses, maybe taking
Well, they would have had to buy the license for the guided trip. What you said is very irrelevant.
But they could also do that in other places now. You're part of being a guide is Same teaching place, other people how to do what you're doing.
Right.
I so get that. You're a success in one way. In another way, it's a there's pros and cons, I guess.
I think that the conversation in the boat with the guide is everything at that point. Because if I was like, yeah. hey, Jacob, today you're teaching me how to fish this river and what to do and how to work things. And you're very inquisitive from like the aspect of like learning. And he knows that going in. And then when he sees you on the river later, he's not like, all right, I hate that guy. Because he like accepted that ahead of time. It's like when he knows. Now, if you go there and you're like, catching fish all day and don't say a word, and then he sees you out there the next day, I feel like his emotions towards you would be different than had he known going in you were learning to fish that river specifically. Yeah, it sounds like I had the perfect answer. You guys don't have anything else to say to it.
I mean, I'm still, what I said, I still believe in. I think it's just that it's wrong to do that to someone who's taught you what they know, and that's part of their business, like their livelihood.
I would say yes if you're, like you said, with morel spots or woodcock spot. But if you're in a public river and
you really don't have...
Yeah, but that, yeah. I mean, a lot of guys, you know, guide on public land.
Mm-hmm. Understanding that then the people that they take out are probably going to come back here if they want to do it again.
Yeah, but then as a guide, you always have to, like, account for that and always be switching things up. Like, if you're in Alaska and it's like... in the middle of nowhere, it's like, hey, good luck following the caribou herd and hoping that Correct. They're there in 2 weeks.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's a little different, but a stationary game, such as a timber duel that's going to freak with the same area, mm-hmm. or I'll get the hiccups now mid-show, that'll be awesome, or morel mushrooms, which are literally stationary. Really? I think there's like an ethics to it. Because even the Manistee River, like different parts of the river catch different fish at different times. Mm-hmm. Like knowing where holes are doesn't necessarily, you know, determine a fish. But I really think the answer is how you go about talking to the guide. Like if you're like misleading them. But if you're like, hey, I'm learning how to fish the river. I have my own boat. I know what to
That's
do.
That's a good point.
And I really need to learn from you how to do it. Can you show me everything that you feel comfortable showing me? You don't got to take me to your honey holes or anything, but this is the situation. I think it changes things.
Yeah, it's how you're going to go into it. If you're going into it trying to steal spots at the end of the day, then yeah, ethically it's wrong. But
it costs more if you want to go on that trip.
If you want to do it and save money, then go for it. But at the time, guides always have much more equipment than you're probably going to have on hand.
That's a good point, too. You're always going to be slightly under-equipped compared to what they have.
Correct. Yeah.